entrusted to the Church a sacrifice due for all eternity, the banquet of his love. Grant, we pray, that we may draw from so great a mystery the fullness of charity and of love. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit,
precious in the eyes of God. received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also the cup, after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Unhappy at what he was doing. But the largest revolt came
when tens of thousands of men marched on London in anger at what the king was doing. People did not want these changes. They did not want what the king was doing. This march, this rebellion, we call the Pilgrimage of Grace. It was the most serious threat that Henry VIII faced in his time as king. And he only defeated these brave souls through lying and treachery. But on this Pilgrimage of Grace, as these faithful people marched in defiance of what the king was doing, one of the cries of the people was this: "Give us the Mass." For most of the people marching against their king, this is what it boiled down to: "Give us the Mass." It was their ardent desire to go to Jesus Christ in the most holy sacrifice of the Mass. That their king had taken this away confused them, filled them with despair, and ultimately led to rebellion and anger. It was a remarkable moment in history. My dear brothers and sisters, my dear friends, watching this Holy Mass tonight through the marvels of the internet, unable to be here in this chapel at this Holy Mass on this holy night, I'm sure that the cry of those pilgrims 500 years ago, those brave souls, is something that you feel tonight. Give us the Mass. However, the great difference is that the Mass is still being celebrated. The Holy Sacrifice is still being offered for the forgiveness of sins. As St. Pio said, Padre Pio, the world can no more do without the Son than we can do without the Mass. And yet the sadness at this time in history is that we are not able to be together in our churches for this sacred moment. We priests realize the pain and the sadness that you must feel of not being able to go to church, to our familiar places, not being able to go to Mass, and above all, not being able to receive our Lord in Holy Communion. That distance, that pain, is heightened on this night where we thank God for the great gift of the Holy Eucharist. And so be assured that you are in our prayers, in our hearts, at this Mass on this holy night. As I offer this Mass tonight, standing at the altar, know that you are there in that offering. You, our loved ones, this whole world redeemed in the precious blood of our Saviour, all of time and history is united in this sacred moment where bread and wine become the body and the blood, the soul and divinity of Jesus Christ. This is the profound truth which we celebrate on this holy night. This precious and awesome gift of Christ Himself in the altar, the sacrament of the altar given for us. And so please do not let yourselves be disheartened or filled with resentment or bewildered or perhaps even led to anger that you cannot be at Mass, that you cannot be in our churches, that you are unable receive Holy Communion. Remember that despair and anger has no place in the heart of a Christian. Remember that for us as sinners, we can never make demands. In the face of the cross, we can never make demands. We cannot demand the Mass. We cannot demand Holy Communion. We cannot demand eternal life. What we can do is desire it. Desire the Mass. Desire Holy Communion. Desire eternal life. That is what this night must remind us about this year. The desire of our hearts to receive the Lord, to know him, to love him, and one day be with him forever in the joy of eternal life. There is an old saying that absence makes the heart grow fonder. Well, this time of separation of people from the public celebration of the Mass, it's a time then to let hearts grow fonder of what we are deprived of. Perhaps we should reflect how easily and how cheaply we at times treat the Holy Mass, how much we take it for granted that God who created all things, that God who made the skies and the sun and the moon and the earth, that God created all that there is, all that there was, and all that will be, that God who did all those things, allowed his only Son to be betrayed, to die upon the cross for the forgiveness of sins, and then gave us the gift of Calvary at every Mass until the end of time. Consider that. Consider what it is that we miss. Consider that absence. And remember what an awesome gift it is that Christ gives himself to us. And remember that it is a gift. It's a sacrifice. None of us is so worthy of such a great gift, and a gift that God freely gives to the world and to each of us. But it is a gift, an offering given. You cannot demand a gift. It can only be freely given and freely received. And that's why tonight, in this Holy Mass, we thank God for the gift of the Eucharist, for the gift of Jesus Christ, for the gift of being able to receive him. And we desire him. And we can long for that. And even though we're absent from our churches, even though our pews are empty, we can still make that spiritual communion. We can still be united with our Lord on the altar. For those of you at home tonight, for those of you watching, send your angel here tonight. Send your guardian angel to be with us and then to bring the blessings of this Mass back to you. And remember that that's real. That's not just a pious thought that may be comforting. It's real. And that's something we remember this night. That in the Garden of Gethsemane, the angels, well, they were there to comfort the Lord. But for us to receive our Lord in Holy Communion, for us to have the awesome wonder of the Mass, we need then the gift of the priesthood. And so tonight, on Holy Thursday, we pray for our priests, we pray for vocations to the priesthood, and we pray not just for any priest, but for good priests, for holy priests, for priests who have the heart of their Savior. We know, all of us, with hearts full of remorse, that not all of our priests have lived up to their vocation in recent years. The scandals of abuse, the scandals that we've seen in the newspapers, that we've heard even from relatives and friends, they can break our hearts. They can make us feel distant from God. But we must never allow the sins of any priest to come between us and Almighty God in this Holy Sacrament. And I say this as a sinner. Sometimes I say to parishioners, if you're looking for the biggest sinner in the parish, then look no further. I'm standing right in front of you. And yet, when I go to the altar, when I celebrate the sacraments, as any priest throughout the world, Christ's overwhelming love flows through these sacraments into our lives. There is a beautiful story of St. Francis. The holy saint was close to the end of his life. He was unable to walk, suffering from an eye disease and, of course, the stigmata. As he was brought through a region, some people from a nearby town came to ask for his help with their parish priest. Their parish priest was misbehaving, and he wasn't living up to his sacred calling. And so they asked the saint to come to their town and to confront their parish priest. And so St. Francis went to the town, and he was placed before the priest in front of everybody in the town. And the people all thought that the saint would upbraid this fallen priest, give him a good telling off that he deserved. Instead, St. Francis fell to his knees. He took the priest's hands into his own stigmatized hands, kissed them, and said, "All I know, and all I want to know, is that these hands give me Jesus." And that led to the conversion of that priest. He put behind him his sinful ways and lived then a life worthy of Christ. And sinners though we priests are, it's to the abiding glory of God that he chooses the weak to show his strong. And so please pray always for your priests. Pray especially this time for priests caring for the sick, celebrating the sacraments in the face of this terrible pandemic. And remember that the Mass has not been taken away from you. The Mass is still celebrated, is still offered. It can never stop. But we will be back together again. We will be restored to this great sacrament. But in this time where we're absent from the celebration together, on how wonderful it is that we have the Mass. How beautiful it is that we can receive our Lord in Holy Communion, that these gifts of bread and wine become his body and his blood. Give us the Mass, the pilgrims cried, for that may be an echo that we hear tonight, but it's an echo that we can cry in the desire of our hearts, demanding nothing of God except his forgiveness, his mercy, and that on a sinner's lips like mine, the cross of Jesus Christ should shine. Amen. Brothers and sisters, let us now pray together to our loving Saviour, who said, "A new command I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you." In fulfillment of our love for each other, let us now pray for the Church and for the whole world. On this holy night, we pray for our brothers, who serve God as priests of Jesus Christ. May they be renewed by God's grace, and faithfully follow the example of Jesus, the great high priest. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all men called to the sacred priesthood, especially for Brother Gildas preparing for the priesthood. May more young men have the courage to answer the call of God. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Christ who suffered and died for us, bring them comfort and strength.
Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
We pray for those who have died, and especially all those men who served in the sacred priesthood. May they find everlasting peace in the arms of God. Lord, hear us. Let us join our prayers for those of Mary, Our Lady of Sorrows, as we say together, Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God and the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy Church.
Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries, for whenever the memorial of the sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
this most sacred day on which our Lord Jesus Christ was handed over for our sake, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious Ever Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Peter, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysostomus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting hand. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make you, as we observe the day on which our Lord Jesus Christ handed on the mysteries of his body and blood for his disciples to celebrate. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. We plead to God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect, make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, for our salvation and the salvation of all, that is, today, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of this in memory of me. Your divine majesty, so that all of us
also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us for the sign of faith, and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. Cross all your servants, who, though sinners, open your abundant mercies. Graciously grant them share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Sanctum ego sacramentum.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, as the Church approaches the anniversary of that day, when you conferred your priesthood on the apostles and on us, I renew now, in the strength of the Holy Spirit, the promises I made on the day of my priestly ordination. With humility and faith, I, Hugh Allan,
Stephen Morrison,
pious God,
resolve to be more united with you, and more closely conformed to you, denying myself and confirming those promises about sacred duties towards your Church, which, prompted by love of you, I willingly and joyfully on the day I was ordained a priest. I resolve to be a faithful steward of the divine mysteries in the Holy Eucharist and the other liturgical rites, and to discharge faithfully the sacred office of teaching, following you, the head and shepherd, not seeking any gain,
but moved only by zeal for souls. How humbly I ask for an outpouring of the gifts and graces I need for my priestly service, so that, supported by the prayers of the people entrusted to my care, and working with my brother priests, I might remain faithful in my ministry to you, the High Priest, and lead your people in the way of salvation. I pray for my Bishop Allan Williams, that he may be faithful to the apostolic office entrusted to him, so that in our midst he may be made day by day a living and more perfect image of you, the priest, the good shepherd, the teacher and servant of all. Lord Jesus, graciously keep us all in your love, and lead all of us, shepherds and flock, to eternal life. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.